So, in or first of all, I'm Audrey Alexander. I'm a research fellow with the program on extremism, and I get to do research on the nexus of women and terrorism, which is probably why they're letting me grab the mic and help facilitate this conversation today. So, in collaboration with the Georgetown Institute for Women, Peace, and Security, the program on extremism is really thrilled to host a discussion about the future of women and violent extremism. I think that this event is really important, especially getting these panelists. I mean, how rarely do you get all of the people that you first wanted to get? It's a tough feat, and I'm pretty sure I followed Hillary Mathis to her hotel once asking her. So I'm so pumped to have these guys on board because I think that the perspectives are going to be really fascinating, and I've, in communications with them, really asked them to sort of focus on what's around the curve and not just focus on what we've learned. So. Sort of moving that forward. Another reason this event is really important is because we're getting ready to kick off a paper series at the Program on Extremism on this exact same theme. We're still picking out some of the authors and still finagling some of the logistics. But what we're trying to do is in many ways look beyond just sort of the dialectical between an organization and a person and what leads them to violent extremism, but really looking at the conditions, the tools, the group, the ideology, all of these factors and how they can intersect with gender, especially in the mobilization and recruitment, and of course the policy angle looking at how we can intervene. So we're not here to listen to me, weirdly, to as fun as it is to hear me spout off about a paper series. I think that we should dive on into it and get ready for a robust discussion. Again, when I reached out to these panels before and asked them to speak at the event, I told them I wasn't really interested in hosting a token discussion where we sort of say they're not all jihadi brides. So as much as we can sort of kick that from our dialogue and even the question and answer session, that would be awesome. And I think that what I'm most excited for is having our panelists draw from their work to help forecast emerging threats, anticipate the challenges stakeholders might face in preventing, detecting, and countering women's involvement in extremism. And I'm gonna go down the line and sort of introduce our speakers. So we're gonna have Hillary go first, and Hillary is the author of Women in the War in Boko Haram. She's also a PhD student at Yale and juggling 6,000 things at once, including our busy schedule for today. Then we have Nimi Gothu-Nathan, who's the founder and director of the Politics of Sexual Violence Initiative, and a visiting research professor at the Colin Powell Center for Global and Civic Leadership at City College, New York. Then we have Jamila Bigo. Is that right? Biggio. Oh no, my phonetics failed me. Jamila Biggio. Okay. Who is a senior fellow for Women and Foreign Policy at the Council on Foreign Relations. And then we have Christy Schindler, who's an intelligence analyst at the National Counterterrorism Center. So just so we can lay it out really quickly, we're gonna have each presenter speak for about 10 minutes, and I'll keep an eye on the time, but we can have a little bit of flexibility because we're all here to hear what you have to say. And then we're gonna dive into a question and answer session where I will probably shortly abuse my privilege as moderator and ask some questions I've been dying to ask them all along. And then I will share the great opportunity with all of you. So just getting started, let's have Hillary. Okay.
Great, can everyone hear me all right? I usually project anymore, so that's not usually necessary. Eating into my brief time a little bit, I'd just like to thank you so much for putting this together and for everyone for coming out. It's a tremendous honor to be seated at this table. And I'll do my best not to change your opinion on me after Audrey's introduction. And so as Audrey mentioned, my background is on women and Boko Haram. But through that process, I've been interested more generally in what is the process by which women become violent, right? And so I think a lot of us are raised, even here in the United States, with a sense that women are peace brokers, that women are naturally nonviolent, women are softer. And unfortunately, I've been really frustrated by the echoing of that framing in a lot of the discussions about women encountering violent extremism. So I'm sure we've all read these reports, oftentimes with like pink and purple covers, about how women are integral to the peace process. And that's certainly true. And I don't want to defame that literature, because it's certainly important to have women involved in the peace process. But equally important is recognizing that women can be violent. And we have to understand the ways in which women contribute, not just through physical violence, but also through the more invisible logistical support towards armed groups in some of the phenomena that are destabilizing regions today. And so the central question that I'm really curious about in my research now and in my research previously about women in Boko Haram is what drives a woman to join with one of these groups, and what drives women to support them, and what are the invisible ways in which women's labor can support armed groups and terrorist insurgencies, as we're focusing in on today. So with Boko Haram, one of the most surprising interactions that I had in my time conducting research in the Lake Chad Basin and in Northeast Nigeria, most specifically, was at an IDP camp that was being run by Governor Kashim Shettima of Borno State for women who had joined Boko Haram voluntarily and who had been quote-unquote rescued by the government but who had remained loyal to the sect. So I got there to camp early and I was waiting for my translator because I don't speak Hausa or Kanuri. Shocking, I know. And one of the girls was laying on a mat tracing out her ABCs while she was waiting for her tutor. And so I, to kill time more than anything, went over and started showing her how to spell her name, how to spell my name, how to spell the name of other people in the camps in English. And by the time that my translator arrived, we had built up a working relationship. We had a bit of a rapport. And so I was able to ask her, you know, why would you join Boko Haram? My name is Hillary, I knew her name. And she said very simply that it was one of the only reliable ways to get access to consistent education. And that was heartbreaking to me. I mean, this was a girl that even in the confines of a very small IDP camp was working to try and learn her English ABCs, who had been so frustrated by the lack of opportunity to get an education that she had joined up with a Salafi jihadist terrorist organization that's widely decried around the world for its treatment of women and girls. So there are a number of these different structural drivers within countries' political economies and their socioeconomic treatment of women that we need to start unpacking if we are to understand what drives women to support them. So in Boko Haram specifically, as I mentioned, access to education, because Boko Haram does do Quranic preaching on a daily or near daily basis. Women also joined because the bride price that they would receive in exchange for marriage, while lower than the regular bride price, would be paid directly to them. Women also joined Boko Haram in my research because of the social status that came with it. So Boko Haram practices something called purda, or wife seclusion, which means that if you're to leave your sort of domestic compound, you cover yourself entirely. And as a Western feminist, I sort of kicked against this as a notion of empowerment. But then I started hanging out in my degree in the hot season and realized that practicing purda also means that women cannot engage in agricultural labor. And so this was really a way of improving their material well-being as well as being a status symbol. And so all of these drivers aren't the sort of sensationalized, you know, dare I say, sexy portrayals of what drives women to join these extremist groups, but I think they have a lot more explanatory power. And similarly, and I know I'm eating into my time, so I'll try and summarize quickly, similarly, the roles that these women play in Boko Haram aren't necessarily the sort of sensationalist, very, I think, one-dimensional portrayals of what women in armed groups do. So it's not just that they were jihadi brides, even though they were frequently the brides of fighters. They were often responsible for things like logistics. They were responsible for maintaining order in the camps when their husbands left to go on raids. They were often responsible for going to the market and purchasing some of the sort of necessities to keep a camp running, things like magi cubes, the food seasoning, or acquiring fuel for the motor vehicles. Women are integral to the basic functioning of the group, but because they may not hold a weapon while they're contributing to the group's agenda, we often overlook them. And so today, with my last few minutes, I'd like to outline what I see as a critical research agenda for understanding women in armed groups. And it's first understanding the structural drivers that push women towards joining groups, things like gender-based violence, things like a lack of opportunity, things like obstacles to achieving their social status, but also looking at the invisible ways in which they contribute to a group's function. I think that, you know, we acknowledge that for millennia, women's contributions to the domestic front, to doing invisible labor in the homes, were overlooked, and we're seeking to rectify that now in terms of how women contribute to the functioning of the household. But I think we need to apply that same lens to the functioning of armed groups and terrorist groups as well, to identify invisible labor and logistical support that women are often integral to in these sorts of groups. And so I'm so looking forward to this discussion, and I welcome your questions, and I think I didn't go too far.
Okay, next we're going to have Nini.
Hi, thank you for having me. I spent somewhere around 20 years with women in the liberation fighters of Tamil and Sri Lanka. The majority of my work has been there. I'm Tamil and Sri Lankan. I've also spent time with women in Eritrea, women in the FARC. And my work is largely on how rape, displacement, militarization, all these aspects of conflict, how they shape women's political identities. These are things that we see as aspects that shape them socioeconomically, psychologically, and we don't examine the political impact. So a few thoughts on this. For me, the female fighter as it's come to be understood today is at this intersection of both entrenched gender perceptions and the rise of xenophobia. As a fighter, she's a monster, she's a sociopath. As a woman, she's broken. There are some assumptions operating around the female fighter that I want to get into. I want to be able for us to break down these assumptions and understand the damage that the assumptions are causing. The first is that women are always manipulated and brainwashed into joining these groups, right? It's not terribly uncommon that the first thing to be assumed about a woman is that she doesn't have a brain. In here you see this further invisibility or erasure, right? This is this thing that we talk about quite a bit in feminism, that we don't want to have erasure of women's voices, right? But in this aspect, there's an inability to see women's politics, distinctive politics. And that's not only dangerous to me, it's anti-feminist. When you look at some of the interrogators who worked with women who were joining some of these movements, there was a woman in India who was being joined, was about to join, and they stopped her. And the interrogator kept saying how surprised he was, how shocked he was at her analytical ability. And not only her knowledge of Sharia law, but her ability to connect it to the various injustices happening in the Muslim world. Right? The second assumption is she joins because of a man. This is a relatively common assumption. Again, we have a tendency to read the politics of women, particularly in the developing world, through the men around her. Right? In Paris, the assumption was that this was because of her boyfriend. In Jordan, you had Sajida al-Rashawi, who was married 2 days before the failed suicide bomb attack on a hotel, which to me reads as a woman who used a man to express a particular politics, rather than joining a movement because of a man. You know, there's this overall assumption that women are these apolitical beings. They just sort of exist as these untethered blank slates. Right, and any image they come across in social media, any conversation, any man is able to then radicalize them. Right? They have no politics to start with. The third major assumption is culture, that these local cultures and religions are limiting her agency. Right? This is the one that I hear particularly most often. Culture is a very useful perpetrator, right? Because if culture is a perpetrator, then there's nobody to blame. Nobody's held accountable. Right? Even in the UN, you see this idea that transformative change is connected to culture. Right? The assumption here is that culture is static. It's this one unchanging thing that exists all over the developing world. Culture is not static. It wraps around context. It will always wrap around context. And the question of agency, this is, you know, important. This idea of agency comes up over and over again. When you're looking at countering violent extremism, it's important to ask the question, which feminism is driving this conversation? Okay? Which agency are you looking at? The majority of questions of agency create a context in which we're only willing to see a woman whose struggle is against male domination. She has to be fighting for women's rights in order for us to see her as the part of the struggle. This, in my opinion, limits our ability to have cross-cultural understandings of what political agency is. When you're dealing with something, even in the US right now, there's a very clear indication, a very clear pattern of how extremism overlaps with patriarchy. Right? That will always happen. One example, you had extremist Buddhists in Sri Lanka recently who were attacking Muslims. Right? And you had the Muslims fighting back, and the conversation about the Muslims fighting back, and then within that resistance, you had Muslim men discussing what color niqab Muslim women should wear so that they would be less at risk. Now, the black seemed too obvious, but they didn't want her to wear green because it might get dirty and that would be un-Islam. No? So all of these assumptions contribute to this creation of a monster, to the construction of a victim, and to the distortion of the female fighter. And all of these assumptions then shape the solutions that we have to save this woman. So last week, or a few days ago actually, I was in London, and I was able to meet the woman who trained the women in the Tigers. This was almost 4 years ago now. The initial women who joined the movement were training in the jungles. And I was discussing with her the complexity of the female fighter, and the first thing she said, is it complex? She said, I don't see it as complex. She said, they joined because of state repression. So my work looks at context. It looks at the context around these women, right? To me, female fighters are described as antisocial elements, rather than mimicking the violence of the states that they come from, mimicking the violence of the societies they come from, right? You have this passive versus active construction of what their reality is. They're simply minorities. They're simply marginalized. There is no active process of marginalizing them, of minoritizing them, of making women in a vulnerable position. Right? Going back to culture, again, my work looks at the ways in which culture wraps around context. I was in Afghanistan and Sri Lanka. You had plenty of girls who were not going to school, whose fathers didn't want them going to school. But it wasn't because they didn't believe in education. It was because there was checkpoints on the way to school, and they would be raped on the way to school. Perhaps he didn't believe in education, but the culture is not something that we can change from the outside. The only thing you can change is the checkpoint. That is in your control, right? The context of militarization, and militarization is something that people think is just a necessary aspect of conflict. Militarization is actually an active process. It's deeply entrenched. It changes the values of the society. It means that a woman in Northeast Sri Lanka cannot go buy vegetables without interacting with someone in the military. Right? It increases the likelihood of rape. It increases the likelihood of alcoholism. The impact of that on women changes their politics. I'm always asked the question about culture, and I always wonder, what about all the other cultures? The culture of violence, the culture of dependency, and the people who are responsible for that. In a recent study on de-radicalization, which the Sri Lankan government helpfully hopes to be the model of de-radicalization. The study says, in the context of terrorism, feminism refers to the motivation to prove that women matter, that they are as worthy as men, as committed to the cause, and as willing to undertake sacrifices on its behalf. What's fascinating is that this driver identified in this study as significance quest, that women are searching for an individual sense of significance, never links the feeling of insignificance to state repression. Okay? The state in these studies has disappeared. Why a community might feel insignificant is not considered. I recently interviewed Kimberly Fenchow for a female fighter series that I had at Guernica Magazine. And I wanted to know from her, when I discuss a female fighter, it's very easy for people to make the female fighter something out there. Not here in this country. It's something foreign, it's something third world. And I interviewed Kimberly Crenshaw on the potential for black militancy here amongst women. And one of the ways she described it was a reaction, a potential reaction to state violence. And she's very clear, not just the poke baton against the head of the police, but the violence of ever-restricting opportunities for living, for thriving, for working, for creating, for producing, for black people in this country. So state violence is something that we don't consider in these contexts. The second aspect of this is the question of choice. Much of the debate on women extremism is about whether or not she had a choice. Right? Did she have a choice when she joined? Was she abducted? My early research was on why women join the Tigers, and when I met them, almost all of them said, well, I was abducted. And then you can't write a dissertation on that. But what I found was, the more time I spent with them over 20 years, is that we overemphasized that moment. Because you had a number of women who went on to become senior cadres in the movement, senior lieutenants, who had the opportunity to leave and didn't leave. So if you were abducted, ideally if you had the chance to leave, you would have left. Right? What I found in the research was that that moment wasn't as relevant. It was an entire life history that had to be considered. Even though they were socialized the same, they saw the same videos, the same propaganda, only those for whom those videos related to a prior moment of state repression were the ones who stayed. Only those for whom they were able to associate it with the bombing that they saw, with an inability to access health care, with being harassed at a checkpoint, those were the women who stayed in the movement, who became committed cadres. I do work also on gender-based violence, but it's sort of a long subject in itself. The main point of my work on gender-based violence is to say that it has a deep impact on women. Where we are able to say that rape is a political act, we're not able to say that it has a political impact. Right? And the impact for most women is one of extreme marginalization. As a fighter, she can't go back to her village. As a member of a minority community, she can't go back to the community. She's bad luck at weddings and funerals and all kinds of other events. As a Tamil, let's say in this case, she's already a minority on the outside of the state. Right? So she's in this position of extreme marginalization. My recent work is on rage. And I'll read it a little bit from the book. Rage has been limited to masking sadness, mimicking masculinity, marketing activism, and revealing madness. Analysis only dulls and distorts it. It cannot revel in its inherently political self. Rage for women is more emotively driven than anger and more intellectually tempered than its enemy. The radical violent female fighter is the extreme that reveals the rage in the everyday, the rape that pushes her away from society, the marriage that traps her within it, the military occupation that intrudes on her every movement, and the peaceful savior who seeks to extract her voice from the body it inhabits. So I'll just end with this discussion of countering violent extremism and point out that we have a new paper out called The Emissaries of Empowerment, and it looks at the failure of empowerment as a depoliticizing tool. And the female fighter is this uncomfortable position in the aid complex. She's neither a victim to be saved nor entirely an agent of her own actions. She's the latest rape victim, war widow, mothers of the disappeared, beneficiary. To these women, interveners most often offer empowerment, construed in the narrow sense of providing traumatized women with economic support for small-scale businesses. In examining the highly politicized woman, the female fighter, the disconnect is the clearest in how depoliticizing these interventions are. Yes, combatants I know will tell me, sewing is of no use to me. When I finish the course, only then would they say I was de-radicalized. In Bogota last month, I was with Sandra, a senior fighter in the fact, and she said when she came, the war ended, the first people to approach her were NGOs offering livelihood support. And she said, I said no back then, and I said no today, and they still dropped off their sewing machines. And she says she fears that these programs are partially responsible for women active in the fire losing their politics. So I'll end with just, again, the question of gender TV programming. One, I would hope you consider whose feminism this is. Right? The idea that one should include the perspective of women in foreign policy has increasingly become a space occupied by white feminism. There are very, very few women of color in this space. It's one of the reasons I'm here today. But beyond that, how does that change the conversation? And you know, what kinds of things are real we're looking at? Like the politics of memory, by giving out sewing machines. Almost every woman in the fighter, the Tigers, will say today that they miss their time under the tigers. They wish the tigers were still there. So I'll end it with that and take questions.
So I think the first two presentations so far have shown us a lot about, I think, what both of you sort of hit on independently is the idea of, we've been assigning a lot of a Western interpretation of what is a woman to our policy analysis and evaluation, and that really shapes our programming. So it's sort of a perfect slide down to Jamila, because one of the things I asked her to speak to is sort of what is the future of policy design, especially as we start to come to terms with more realistic evaluations of women and extremism. And then we'll, after that, move to the sort of intelligence perspective and actual items for the future.
That's great. Thank you, Audrey. So I think what Hillary and Mimi both shared are some critical points to understand what are some of the unique motivators and drivers for women engaged in with extremist groups. Right now, the U.S. government's policies, programs shaped around de-radicalization, reintegration, either do not even acknowledge that there are female fighters who should benefit from the de-radicalization, reintegration, accountability, et cetera, efforts, or then don't shape thoughtful interventions around it. To the example of giving sewing machines, because that is our own gender norms or our own conceptions around what opportunities women would look for to reintegrate into society. So there's a lot of space there on the US policy side to look at to actually respond to what are effective ways to de-radicalize female fighters, to reintegrate them, and that's both true abroad in terms of U.S. foreign assistance, counterterrorism CPE programs abroad, and it's true as well domestically. That within the United States too, the U.S. government hasn't looked at how are women being radicalized here, what are the motivators here, and making sure that U.S. government programs actually thoughtfully engage in that role and look at ways to really effectively de-radicalize and reintegrate women here. On looking at the policy side, there's a gap both in recognizing the ways in which extremist groups are strategically using women to their advantage, the way in which women seek to participate in extremist groups. But on the flip side of that conversation, there's also the challenge that counterterrorism efforts have not effectively looked at women's roles. So very much taking the point that we don't want the conversation to end at, well, women are peaceful, they are peacemakers, that's the only role that they have in society. Yes, they are influential in whatever role that they have. And right now, though, in the CT/CBE space, we actually see them in some ways being given more credit and attention for the influence that they're having within extremist groups than the influence that they're having in countering violent extremism or countering terrorism. And in fact, this is something that it took seeing female fighters for governments and others focused on the countering violent extremism side to say, oh, women are having influence and impact. How can we better partner and work with them and support their roles on the countering violent extremism side? And there's research looking at the ways that women are detecting early signs of radicalization, where their rights and freedoms are some of the first to be infringed upon, including, for example, from rising harassment in public spaces to barriers sending their daughters to school and other challenges that as communities become more segregated. Right now, my sense, and curious to hear your sense on the intelligence side, is that those indicators aren't consistently tracked as warning signs of potential rise in extremism, or where they are, those warnings go unheeded. So in Libya, for example, analysts observed a flow of Western female recruits consistent with the need for different support roles for women as the Islamic State established a headquarters there. And at the same time, local women reported increasing infringements on their rights, including being harassed for driving alone. But both of these warnings went unheeded, providing time for the Islamic State to establish itself before counterterrorism efforts ramped up. So there, where we do have research pointing to indicators that can inform and help guide counterterrorism, counter-violent extremism efforts, those aren't yet given credence or given policy priority. One of, I think, the most often noted spaces on the preventing violent extremism side is where women are positioned to either mitigate or encourage radicalization, that where their influence with youth and in families and in communities, that they are, again, influential and can be influential in either direction, either in encouraging their families, youth, their communities towards or away from radicalization. And yet, traditional efforts by governments and NGOs to combat radicalization usually focus on political or religious leaders who are predominantly men and don't engage women in that role. Countries are starting to learn on that front. Morocco has recognized women's influence and educated women to become as religious scholars and sent them to where radical Islamists were targeting disenfranchised youth for recruitment, so looking for women to help be a countering force there where that is the message that they can help carry, but that's certainly not done enough now. A third area is looking at women as security officials, that they can provide distinct insights and information that can be mission critical. First, having female security officials to help ensure that female fighters cannot move freely. So this is closing a security loophole now where that extremist groups are taking advantage of, that if they are guessing that there is not a female security official at the checkpoint and that a woman will be able to pass unsearched, then that provides a strategic advantage to the extremist group that we see Boko Haram certainly using in Nigeria with the number of female suicide fighters being used there. We've seen it in Afghanistan where men have dressed as women to pass through search points unchecked. And so this is a loophole, again, to not have more women serving in as security officials. On the other side, there's also the benefits that women's participation offers to improve how local communities perceive law enforcement, to improve the engagement with communities. But both on, in general, U.S. policy in this space hasn't yet really given enough weight to the ways in which women are influential either in extremist groups or through their counterterrorism, counter-violent extremism efforts. And there are some opportunities coming up that can help shape that differently. So there's a congressionally mandated U.S. national counterterrorism, national strategy for countering violent extremist groups. That's an opportunity to include attention to and investment in women's roles, the kind of roles and motivators that we're talking about here today. We've also seen that a lot of the attention to women and violent extremism in the government has been through small grants, small projects with the gender community, and that there's not yet been enough investment from broader security sector policy and initiatives that actually recognizes women's roles, again, on either side of that equation as security priorities, as counterterrorism, counter-violent extremism priorities that should likewise have investment in parallel. Another piece is, as I noted, the lack of women in security sectors. This is an area where the U.S. government can certainly do a lot to support and encourage and provide opportunity for women serving in security sectors, including to benefit from training on countering violent extremism and counterterrorism, so that they can be used to conduct searches, to be engaged in communities and building rapport so that they are there to heed the warning signs and to have more of a broader dialogue to better understand where the radicalization risks are in communities. And finally, noting the attention to better understanding what the needs are for female fighters to actually ensure that U.S. programs are shaped in a way that actually effectively help reintegrate female fighters while providing them the political, economic, while ensuring they continue to have those opportunities so that they do have a chance to contribute positively in their societies and aren't reporting years later, as Mimi shared, that they had greater opportunity in the extremist groups than they do in their societies today. And that's an entry point where certainly, again, policy and programs should be focused.
Awesome. That was wonderful. And I'm really loving how this is building. It's always a shot in the dark when you organize the panel, but I think it's working very well. So now we're going to have Chrissy Schindler. She works for the National Counterterrorism Center as an intelligence analyst. We're going to have her dive in and sort of provide that perspective before we start the question.
Unfortunately, when you're on such a distinguished panel and you go last, you know, there's a lot of pressure, so I'll try to do my esteemed colleagues up here justice. So one of the things that I do with the National Counterterrorism Center is I lead a case study research project for the FBI. And so one of the things we've really been taking a look at, particularly in the Western space and the U.S. space, is sort of how is the terrorism landscape different from the Al-Qaeda age to the ISIS age? And so, you know, each of these individuals kind of highlighted, you know, we really see that in particular with the ISIS age, these lowered barriers to entry, anyone can come and play. Anyone can join these groups, no matter what your background is, no matter what your socioeconomic status is, no matter what your grievances are, and sort of anyone can come along and participate in this kind of activity as either foreign fighters, as plotters, as material supporters. And so I think that's something that's very, very interesting going forward, talking about some of the policies and what the threat landscape is going to look like, is you have this very, very dynamic sort of shifting, anything goes at any time. So what constitutes terrorism has really changed. I think that's an interesting part of the conversation from the prevention standpoint. So Al-Qaeda was very sort of mindful of not wanting to do things that would diminish their brand name. So UBL, Bin Laden, and others, they really wanted to prioritize these high-profile attacks. And so what I think ISIS has done is sort of pushed the narrative. So you see a lot of the propaganda, particularly coming out of Syria and Iraq. Women have evolved beyond just sort of wives and mothers in jihadi wives, as others have mentioned. So you're seeing, in February, you're actually seeing ISIS propaganda being released that shows women fighting right alongside men in these conflict zones. And so you're seeing these increased roles that run the gamut. And as such, I think you're seeing the women join these groups for a variety of reasons. It can be as simple as sort of wanting to belong to a group or feel a sense of purpose or a sense of adventure, all the way up to some of the ones that had less sort of autonomy and agency over their decisions and did indeed go to join their husbands or rear children in these groups. And so I think one of the assumptions that we tend to make writ large is that somehow terrorism is different, and sort of that these groups and these people that are attracted to these groups are somehow different than other individuals. And so I think one of the things that's interesting is that ISIS has been very, very adept at sort of speaking to just normal kind of developmental needs, particularly amongst youth, particularly amongst women. And so in the terrorism prevention space in particular, I think we're challenged from the assumption at the outright that somehow terrorism prevention is different than general forms of violence prevention and thus must be addressed as such. And so I think when you're seeing, particularly in the US and the West, you're seeing an increasing number of converts who were not born into the faith, have no kind of socio-political or ethnic ties back to Islam or any of these groups. And so what would motivate a 19-year-old sitting in Colorado to join this group looks very, very different than someone who may be a second generation, who's came in, who's the child of immigrant parents, and who feels a little bit of tension between, say, their role as an American and kind of their role is connected to their home country or their sort of, you know, legacy through their own family. And so one of the things that I think is going to continue to pose a challenge is a few of them, unfortunately, we're all going to be gainfully employed for a very long time. So I think when you're looking at the issue of women who travel to these conflict zones as foreign fighters, there's the issue of repatriation. So sometimes we don't know how many women have gone over there. We don't know how many women have born children over there. We don't know how many have had multiple husbands and, you know, sort of their status. And a lot of the, our European partners are tightening some of their laws regarding repatriation and sort of choosing to let Iraq and other countries handle this. Or you see women that are displaced in internment camps and sort of you don't see prospects or pathways to kind of repatriation to Western countries. So I think that's going to cause a little bit of a conundrum for us because you've seen women attracted to and going to the Syrian and Iraqi conflict, I think in higher numbers than any other conflict that I'm aware of. So there's the issue of sort of women as foreign fighters, the roles that they played over there, either as jihadi brides in some cases or as active members of the battlefield. You have the children that they may have born over there and the things that they may have been exposed to, and so you have infants in some cases, and you have 15-year-olds, and probably how you would need to address either of those would look a little bit different. And then you also look at women as attackers. And so I think in the US, everyone probably saw the San Bernardino attacker. There was also a woman in January in Minnesota who set fires to her college. She was, you don't see many female arsonists, particularly Islamically motivated, but she was claiming that she was doing this for U.S. military actions in Iraq and Afghanistan, and so she set some fires at her college. So again, it just, you're seeing women lone actors, you're seeing women as part of romantic partnerships, or you're seeing women as part of other small groups or familial groups. So the role of women as fighters is different than the role of women as attackers. And then I think one of the things that it sounds like Audrey may be more of an expert in than I am, is the role of women as recruiters and how the women, how women on the internet and sort of social media, I think this is really a level of playing field. So you have women who are no longer forced to take these passive roles. They can very actively be out and about online recruiting other women, encouraging other women, answering questions on Ask FM about what's it like in the conflict zone? Am I going to have the creature comforts? Are there going to be people that speak my language? What happens to me if I'm not married? How do I find a husband? Do I have any say in that process? And so I think you're seeing Western women in particular. There was Sally Ann Jones, who was recently killed, but she was very, very active and prolific online. Widow of Junaid Hussein, another very active ISIS hacker. And then you're seeing others, like the widow of one of the 7/7 bombers is out and about, sort of very actively recruiting. So these are white convert Anglo women. So I think challenging the notion of what a terrorist is an also important part of the conversation. And then, are their motivations truly different than other forms of criminality, other forms of exploitation? And then looking at some of the future of, I think, the terrorism research, these are low-end incidents for the most part. And so we tend to focus on the ones that just get a lot of media attention, because it's sexy, right? Women out conducting attacks on behalf of these, you know, ideologically motivated groups. I think Mia Bloom looked at this and said 8 times more media coverage is garnered for a woman attacker. So I think there's a question too of, are these groups employing women in more of an operational space as a position of strength or a position of weakness? I think people are debating that in the ISIS space. Is there's additional losses of territory control? Is this kind of a last dying gasp, or is this really a shape, a change in the shape and the way that groups view these operational roles that is likely to continue? So I think, again, you've seen these sort of mixed motivations, different, and then, so that leads to sort of the warning signs and the indicators discussion. So that's a very, very tough one for us in particular. And so one of the things that John Borgen and some of his colleagues have done, not just with females, but sort of terrorism prevention at large, is looked at the issue of bystanders. So who is around these subjects of concern? What do they become aware of? And then what do they do? Do they report their concerns to law enforcement. And this is probably not going to come to a shock as anyone in this room, but no. A lot of times they don't want to report their concerns. They don't want to come forward. And so the reason is they don't want to get their friends or their loved ones in trouble, particularly when you're talking about someone in your life. You're talking about your wife. You're talking about your husband. You're talking about your daughter. You're talking about someone who is very close to you. Asking these individuals to pick up the phone and call the FBI or anyone else, any domestic law enforcement agency, is a very, very difficult ask. So I think that speaks to the importance of the terrorism prevention and the countering violent extremism space. There has to be more in the middle between sort of federal government, FBI, national level kind of terrorism prevention being handcuffs, and actual terrorism prevention as far as multidisciplinary practitioners who are taking a threat assessment approach before someone engages in violence or travels to a conflict zone, and they look at what are we doing? How can we bring our prospective resources to bear to help address this problem or this person in particular, understanding that the motivations can be so different. I think, as some of my colleagues have mentioned as well, we haven't really, because the end is so low, we haven't really been able to take a hard look yet at why terrorism is different for women. Is it different for women? Are the motivations different? And so I think that's what speaks to sort of that need for something in between communities and law enforcement, and as well as sort of encompassing that whole of government multidisciplinary approach. And so I think where the government space ends is we can sort of put forth information, put forth research, try to provide resources and empower local communities. But in many cases, we don't understand those local community dynamics. We're not best positioned to say, here, this is what you should be doing, small town in Kansas, to address your radicalization problem. And so one of the things that we've talked about a little bit, too, is framing terrorism prevention in some ways as general violence prevention. So when you look back at the bystander issue and sort of the phenomenon of people knowing something before something bad happens, it also occurs in school shooters. It occurs in people who seek to assassinate celebrities or political figures. So this notion that people tend to know something before something bad happens, it is pervasive across different threat groups. And so I think where communities and others are sort of reticent to talk about the terrorism problem for a lot of reasons, as some of the panelists have mentioned, it can be marginalizing, it can be stigmatizing, particularly to women. We're not here as the government to police thought. We're not here to police religion. We're not here to police belief systems. And so I think framing some of these conversations in a broader context of ISIS and other groups seek to exploit your children, your women, in similar ways that gangs would, or in similar ways that sex traffickers would in some cases. And then I'm not convinced that, again, terrorism is so different, particularly in the ISIS age. I think that sometimes a woman who's isolated, 16 years old, somewhere online, it's just a matter of who they bump into. And so that speaks to the importance of the online space. I think in some cases we've seen, particularly with converts, they're less ideologically motivated. They don't really even understand sort of the sunnah or the five pillars of Islam or even the difference between Sunni and Shia. They're more just wanting to belong, wanting to be part of something, and these groups are quite adept at exploiting that. And so again, I think some of these women in particular, they bump into the right person, they're not going to be a terrorist. They're going to be sex trafficked, or they're going to be part of a gang, or they're going to be something else in these cases. And so I think one of the things we've tried to do in the research space and we've been challenged to do is also look at some of our assumptions regarding what terrorism is, what women's role in it is, and sort of how we should frame prevention efforts and understanding that a lot of this is going to have to be tailored to the individual. A lot of this is going to have to be tailored to the specific communities.
Great. Okay, so what I won't allow you guys to do before, or when I do the Q&A, I'm going to take the long way around to ask any question and sharing a little research that I think is really pertinent to the question I'm going to ask them. On my beautiful mind note sheet from all of the groundwork we just covered. So in our research on the program on extremism, as I mentioned earlier, I tracked a lot of the cases of bias in America, and one of the things we've noticed, and I'm working with Rebecca Turkington on a piece about this now, if we hurry up, we'll get there. But looking at actually how legal frameworks deal with women who perpetrate violence, particularly as it pertains to terrorism statutes, and how we sort of work at approaching terrorism, both in the sort of, I don't want to say pre-criminal space, but before an arrest, during the arrest, and looking at how we question them, and then looking, of course, at sentencing. So we've noticed a few different discrepancies, and especially if you look at some of the IS in America cases, they're light years away from each other when you start to talk about some of the men's cases and some of the women's cases. And when you start to really dig into it, you start to see other questions about, well, why did they approach somebody earlier in this case when they didn't do it in this case? And one thing I certainly see matters with gender is that terrorism is actually a fundamentally intersectional problem. Your gender, your age, your race, whether or not you're a convert or whether you're born into the faith, at least for the IS in America cases, may affect your interaction with the legal system as a whole. So that's really interesting, because what's great is that we don't, in the U.S. alone, we don't treat terrorism as a malefic act. There are all of these ways that you can disaggregate it, whether you're trying to conduct an attack, or whether you are providing material support or conspiring to provide. And there is a bit of leeway on that, but when we start talking about gender and sort of bringing that component, that's where I start to get a little concerned that we aren't necessarily providing the same opportunities to both men and women, because we may assume that women are not doing it with intention, but we might assume that a man is. So a lot of what we need to talk about as we sort of move to this question is, based on your experiences, what have we learned, or what have you guys learned from either being a practitioner, a researcher, policymaker, analyst, that can improve the ability to not start at ground zero as we start to look at new threats or threats that have been long there, but we're starting to address now. So analyzing women and men in white supremacy movements in the far right. What about other smaller conflicts in Iraq and Syria, such that are in Africa, Southeast Asia, even going all the way back to FARC and reintegration. I wanted to give a fair bit of flexibility, but from what we've learned about the gaps between political identity, the influence of structural conditions, role of culture, going down the line, if we want to do it that way, what would you advise to somebody who's approaching the issue and starting to really look at other groups in terms of best practices in integrating programming and I guess they're conscious of these factors?
Great. So I think first is looking at the indicators and early warning signs. So if we're looking further out in the future to understand where there may be threats and risks in the future, point to the research that both Dr. Valerie Hudson and Hillary have done of understanding as well as demography risks. So where we can point to countries that now have many more men than women because of sex selection, preference for male babies, that combine that with means that there are now many men who cannot find brides. Combine that with societies that have bride prices, you now have societies where men cannot, either there are not enough women there to marry, or they cannot afford the women to marry. And that's become an incentive for greater violence to raise the money or to locate brides. And that those demography bubbles, those demography shifts, the countries where we can see where there are many more men than women, are not necessarily on our tracking list right now of places where we might anticipate there to be extremism in the future. But that research and experience is pointing to, in fact, that they should be. So I think part, and I pointed earlier to indicators around of early signs for where there's segregation in public spaces, where it's hard to send girls to school, that these are all signs of early signs of radicalization and a rise of radicalism. But but not yet, we haven't yet effectively integrated those indicators into our trackers and given weight to them to truly recognize that those are potential signs of threats, of rising threats. So that's one place that I would recommend starting is improving our analysis and our understanding of where those threats are. The second is understanding the variety of roles and ways in which women have an influence, and that, as we talked about, the various roles that they have in extremist groups, as Hillary rightfully pointed out, there's not enough weight given to, not enough attention given to all of the different roles that they play, and then as well on the preventing violent extremism side, that there's likewise not enough attention or investment given to those roles. We also haven't talked here yet about where gender influences male engagement with violent extremism and where they may be radicalized and where that relates to their own engagement. Just to add a few data points on that, so there was a Mercy Corps study that found that the most common reason that Jordanian men cited for joining the war in Syria in this specific study was to protect Sunni women and children. So it's again another targeted use of how gender and how men were seeing their role as protectors, how they were seeing women and children as being targeted and at risk, that those ways in which gender was then influencing their own radicalization. That's one aspect, and then another is the way in which physical violence and attitudes towards women, the role of empowerment of women in the home, how that, Valerie Hudson likewise has a theory that that's a boot camp for men, where men are permitted in their society to use violence against women in the home, or where women don't have rights in the home, that then mirrors what happens in society more broadly, and that those are societies that are more likely to be violent, where there's greater risk of violent extremism as well. So I add that just as another kind of indicator of our understanding of where the risks are. So I think the analysis side of indicators and recognizing the variety of roles and how that plays into both radicalization and countering violent extremism, that both of those should be given more weight and investment than they are now.
So I'll echo all of those points, and to thank you for setting me up to get on three separate of my favorite soapboxes. This is very exciting for me. So one of the things that I think was rightly pointed out by Amy's presentation is that so frequently radicalization of both men and women is a response to fundamental governance issues. And so I very frequently go on this rant of, like, what did we call CVE in the 90s? We called it good governance. Right, and so we need to get back to that kind of fundamental notion that it's much less likely that people will mount a violent insurrection against the state if the state isn't engaging in gross human rights violations against them. So to me, fundamentally, that's at the heart of what we're trying to do here. When we talk about countering or preventing violent extremism, what we're really saying is that we need to repair what is a fundamentally broken relationship between a citizen and the state. One of, I think, the obstacles for the United States to help build strong partnerships that's capable of doing that is the fact that because of Section 660 in the Foreign Assistance Act, which was amended in the 1970s, I know someone will fact check me, there are prohibitions on the United States' ability to train foreign police. And that was something that was pointed out really rightly, that's been highlighted in the research here at the NCTC, that we do need kind of an intermediary between the federal level and local level. And the United States, sort of, you have to apply for waivers to train police, and that even surmountable obstacle, though, has created a situation in which frequently terrorist activity is responded to first by the military rather than the police, despite the fact that there's fairly, to me at least, convincing research an advocacy around the idea that counterterrorism and countering violent extremism is best done at the police level or at the community level. So in terms of you know, the policy response to this, I would advocate, first of all, reorienting our objectives away from a narrow, and I believe often xenophobic and Islamophobic conception of CBE, and orient it towards good governance. And in doing so, reform our legislative framework to enable us to do that in the most effective way possible. And I believe that there's a very strong case to be made for engaging foreign police in that endeavor. A little more academically, I think it's really important to note, too, that the way that we talk about women influences groups' deployment of gender norms and gender identity. And it's a lot less tangible of a thing to talk about, and so I think the policy community often shies away of discussing how gender norms shape insurgency or terrorist groups, targeting decisions, use of women, means of recruiting women, but it's something that we do have to engage with. So as the Mercy Corps and Jordan study pointed out, that men felt a sense of being a protector in going to fight, that's an important social attribute, a social driver of radicalization that we need to engage with. Similarly, in terms of targeting, I'm right now working on a project based off of a data set that I helped compile with the Combating Terrorism Center at West Point about Boko Haram's use of female suicide bombers. And Boko Haram's used more female suicide bombers than, in my estimation, any other terrorist group in history, outpacing the Tamil Tigers, who had previously been the group most dependent on them. And I just finished a paper advocating that it's actually the gender norm disruption that female suicide bombers are more kind of psychologically devastating of an attack because it's both violent perpetrated by women and against women in a very public setting. And that helps explain why Boko Haram has adopted this tactic. And I'm happy to take questions on that. Otherwise, I'll spin out this halfway to theory for you all for hours on end. And so I guess my three kind of key points would be reorienting our policy conversation to be less about CBE per se and more about good governance, to take a good hard look about how our engagement with our security partners abroad is being hampered by what might be, you know, outdated legislative patches, and what sorts of legislation do we need to pass now, what sorts of programs do we need to start to engage in these effective partnerships, and to really think critically about how we portray women so that the sorts of programs that we do design aren't, you know, relying on tropes about women or robbing them of agency or making them more appealing targets for insurgent groups seeking to kind of sow pervasive insecurity and disrupt social and gender norms.
Thank you. I think there's sort of three aspects to this. The first is the overall approach to this. When I first finished my PhD, I got an email right away when it was published online from the U.S. military offering to publish the dissertation. Obviously, a 15-year study of why women join terrorist organizations attracted to the U.S. military. But what I would say analytically and intellectually is that one has to decide whether or not you want to study these women as a threat or if you want to understand these women. The two cannot be reconciled. It makes no sense to me how it is you have a woman, and again, these are our own gender perceptions, a woman who is in forced marriage, a woman who is in hijab, a woman who is a rape victim, and we want to know every aspect of her story. We want to know the details of the rape. We want to make bracelets for her. We want to make baskets for her. We want to have, you know, fundraisers for her, right? But if the woman is a threat, then we don't want anything about her. We don't want to know the story. We only want to know the aspects of her story that make her a threat to us. So from my perspective, I will not look at the female fighter from the point of view of a threat. It's not useful for ending violence. And this, you know, is said as someone who's a political scientist and understands very well why these things are put into certain categories. The second is that studies of the female fighter, male wounds in particular, tend to examine the female fighter in a vacuum, as we do most terrorists, as if everything that happens with them and their communities in this small space happens in this tightly sealed vacuum, and nothing is happening around it. There is no violence, there is no state, there is no destruction, there are no drones. The entire space of analysis exists in this tiny vacuum. And then there's all these intricate theories about what happens
within this vacuum, right? Even this approach, you know, at a macro level, we need to have more women involved, right? That in itself is depoliticizing. You cannot keep having this approach where you can insert women here and expect that things will change. I've been involved in peace talks, you know, after the Tigers and a number of different movements, and you'll have six different chairs here marked for women, right? We should have six women there. But they've already been pre-marked as at the back of the chair has written on it, democratic, pro-West, peaceful, right? And if she doesn't fit those politics, then she doesn't sit in that chair. You don't create peace by a certain number of women, a certain number of men at the table. It's by a diversity of political perspectives. So why are there women who have hardline opinions? Why are there hardline nationalists? Why are there hardline Islamists? Those are part of the process, right? They're connected to violence. In terms of this idea of what we know and what we don't know, this continually shocks me that there's so much that we do know. ISIS is not the first revolutionary movement or whatever you want to call it. Women have been involved in movements for almost 50 years in Eritrea, in the FARC, in Peru, in Nepal, in the Maoists, in different ideological movements, in different violent movements for almost 50 years. There's a good amount of research that's been done on this, right? And what you have with the advent of ISIS is these pop-up research shops where people borrow from other disciplines to suddenly try and understand the female fighter. I've listened to counterterrorism experts describe to me the female fighter on the basis of a Tumblr survey, right? With her final outcomes of the research saying that women are drawn to ISIS because they like pretty visuals and Arabic men on horses. This is not research and this is not analysis. It's not difficult to meet women who join movements. Most of this research comes from individuals who have never met a female fighter. It's not all that difficult to engage with female fighters. And the idea that, you know, the first Born of Earth piece I wrote after ISIS was about gender, because there was a shock that how can women join a movement that's repressive to women? Movements have always been repressive to women. Women have always joined these movements. ISIS is not the first, ISIS will not be the last. Every movement, every social movement, whether it's the Black Panthers, the Tigers, is repressive to women. But they join because they're not fighting for women's rights. They're fighting for Sunni rights, they're fighting for Tamil rights. It's not great to be a woman in the Tamil community. It's conservative, it's not great to be a woman in the Sunni community. There's a lot of conservative ideals that govern you, but you won't die on that basis. You'll die on the basis that you're a Tamil and you're in the area where all the Tamils are killed. You're in the mosque where all the Sunnis are killed. So you will fight along the lines that are under threat. Everybody has multiple identities. You will fight along the identity line that is under threat at that time. The question of indicators, you know, it comes up. I've done, you know, work with you and women and others on this. And, you know, continually I go back to what, again, most of this research is not relying on not just local communities, whatever that means, but on the research being done in these countries. There's a number of Afghan women scholars who will say, I cannot understand why it's so much more injurious, so much more dangerous for a woman to wear a hijab than it is to be bombed by a drone. Right? I cannot understand why the obsession is the hijab and not the drone that's falling on her. Right? It's not a question of good governance, it's a question of violence. It's an analysis of violence and how it affects communities. And sorry, studies like Valerie Hudson's and others, those are macro-level studies that are done using numbers. You cannot understand this kind of intimate engagement with resistance with a macro-level study. And finally, I think if we want to make comparisons, which is the constant tendency, is just to make comparisons, there are some that are more problematic than others. The idea that you can use criminology to understand terrorism. Right? We had a number of conferences I've been at with criminologists using research coming from the 20th century, which is steeped in racism. You cannot just take that and apply that to the contemporary context of women in resistance. What happens is, again, if she's a threat, if she's a terrorist, what you can say is that race and sexism and all these things don't matter anymore, because she's a threat. So we can take all of those out of the window and we can apply criminology. If you want to compare something, compare them to state armies. Compare them to women in state armies. How do women engage in the US military? How do women engage in the Nigerian military? I gave a command lecture to AFRICOM last year on women in militancy. And I sat with the women in the Nigerian and they're doing military. And they said, you know, why are women doing Boko Haram? We don't understand. And we had this long conversation where they described why they joined the state military, because they didn't want to get married, because they could make money, because they could do something that normally in a conservative society they couldn't do. It's not all that different. And if you're able to see this, you get much closer to coming up with an effective policy. If you stop the othering that happens in these conversations, the next piece that comes out in our series is about a town in Pakistan where the Taliban is recruiting women, and women have just joined the police. And both sets of women will say, the only person they're scared of is Allah. Right? But if you can draw those two things together, the difficulty of gender in militant cultures, rather than state non-state, then you have the basis for an effective policy. So where there's going to be comparison, it's to find the right comparisons.
So I couldn't agree more with the sentiment that, particularly on the government side, we tend to be pretty short-sighted and everything looks brand new to us and nothing has ever been considered from sort of the historical perspective. So I absolutely agree that probably lessons learned from additional conflicts, groups, et cetera, would definitely be of help, particularly countering some of that threat mindset. Those of us that do kind of prevention and outreach work in the government, there's not a lot of us, as you can imagine. And so I'm even shocked sometimes that when we go out into communities, even then, some of the things that we're not very clear on what we ask of communities and what we want them to do and who we want them to talk to and how we want them to engage in the space. I was giving a bystander talk to a joint terrorism task force in Salt Lake City, and I said something about taking lessons learned from other disciplines, namely things like suicide prevention, who very aggressively use hotlines, and they say, here's a resource, here's a number, here's a tool that you can call if you or someone you love is at risk for this kind of activity. To my knowledge, and I see Susan, who I think is going to agree with me, I don't think we've ever replicated anything like this in the U.S. So we go out and we tell people, look at these indicators, kind of police your own, look at your own community, and then we sort of leave, and we don't really make clear what the ask is and what we want those communities to do. So back to the Joint Terrorism Task Force in Salt Lake City, after I said there's no national hotline for countering violent extremism for terrorism prevention efforts, there was a guy who worked, I think, for the Bureau of Land Interior or something, one of those big federal agencies, and he said, do you know there's a 1-800 number for poaching on federal land? He said, if someone's out poaching, illegally poaching animals, there's a number that you can call. But you're telling me there's no one in the U.S. federal government that I can call if I'm concerned outside of sort of the FBI space? I said, to my knowledge, no. So again, it speaks to that kind of threat mindset and how we're threat-orientated. And it speaks again to sort of the need for that prevention space and sort of where the government and our equities are really limited and where it's going to take sort of communities, NGOs, and others to pick up the torch and go forward in that space. And another thing I think that's interesting that's missing from some of the terrorism discourse, potentially on women, is sort of that first-person narrative. So you see anti-gang work, anti-substance abuse, and others are really prolific in sort of talking about the impact of these activities in families and what happens to women who either engage in this kind of activity or have loved ones that engage. And so I think the first-person narrative space is something that may be helpful in starting some of the prevention conversation, but it also doesn't stop at prevention. So if you start looking at a public health model, again, I sort of spoke to the intervention space too, taking that multidisciplinary approach, and training social workers on sort of here's what terrorism looks like, here's what radicalization looks like, here's what someone's at risk, here's how it's different, here's how it's not. Same with psychologists and others. There's not a lot of training, there's not a lot of empirically validated data of how to psychologically assess and treat someone who's at risk for this kind of activity or engaging this kind of activity. And I think, again, in the disengagement space, as was already mentioned, I think there's lessons to be learned from other conflicts and disciplines who've had high numbers of women either participating in conflict or going back to kind of the women and children issue I raised is how do you reintegrate, how do you repatriate, how do you treat individuals who have been exposed to horrific things and have maybe been forced or actively chosen to participate in horrific activities. And so, sort of my take was always, what are we asking of communities? So we're out kind of preaching the gospel of see something, say something, and kind of what does that look like, and considering the nature of what we're asking people to do, and that we really are asking a big ask of people who, you know, become aware of concerning information about their loved ones, and then where does kind of our space and sort of the community and that in the middle space begin, and how can we continue to foster that and that conversation and those policies in a meaningful way.
Awesome. So just to sort of summarize that, I think what's really cool is to have from all these different sort of levels of analysis, different takeaways. And that doesn't seem like a disagreement to me as so much as we can actually really speak credibly to different aspects of these movements and dynamics. We have the macro level and the micro level, and really these two complement each other. And as somebody who loves the research and loves the interviews and loves all of these components, nothing is really, as we were saying, happens in a vacuum, and we need to put all of these pieces together, which is why it's awesome to bring all of these minds together. So let's turn around and start seeing. We have 10, 12 minutes left, so keep your questions way shorter than I kept mine. I'm not leading by example. And then maybe we could take two at a time or something.
Hi, Susan Yoshihara, American Council on Women, Peace, and Security. So the administration is writing a strategy right now based on the law that was passed last October. The law is very limited to conflict prevention resolution, and of course to participation in discussion. So I heard so many fantastic things. First of all, I've been to a million of these, and so far you guys are the best. it's just really great. So what specific things, I assume some of you are already advising the administration, and if not, what would you say that their strategy has to have? Noting that the law keeps really limited, and you're talking about something outside that law, like security and counterterrorism is outside of enforcement security right now. What specifically would you have put in it to make sure it gets into those four agencies?
And then we'll take one more question with that. Okay, back here.
Yes, Ms. Amy said that macro research will not work. So what I want to ask is, the micro research might entail special designed policies for each and every case that is studied. Do you think that governments or different sectors might be reluctant and to put in or so much effort and resources to study and solve every case at a time?
Maybe, how about we just take a third question and then we'll do it all as a stretch. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Hannah Sullivan. I'm here from Georgetown University. My question is specifically for Jamila. So you mentioned that rising harassment in public spaces and barriers in sending daughters to school are both indicators of radicalization. So to that end, I have two follow-up questions. First, could you define violent extremism for us so that we can better understand what an indicator of that might be? And second, I think you mentioned two specific areas of research, so I would be curious to know where this research was carried out, and also know whether or not you think these indicators are specific to radicalization within a specific location, or if you consider them to be universal indicators of radicalization and why.
Any takers?
I can start. So, thank you. So there's an analysis done of 30 countries across the Middle East, North Africa, and South Asia that found in the interviews of, I think, over 300 women, that found that women were substantially more likely than men to be early victims of extremism. So here, looking at it in terms of where we see extremist groups have likewise conservative approaches to women's rights, so to close opportunities to women. So these indicators of women having, there being more discrimination in public spaces, less opportunity for girls to go to school, those are all examples of as women are losing rights in their societies as a sign of there being rising influence and rising power of extremist groups putting out an ideology in the community and the community adopting an ideology under which one of the factors is suppression of women's rights. So if that answers that part of your question. I'd also say on the WPS strategy question, so the Women, Peace, and Security Act does in fact include some attention to countering terrorism, countering violent extremism. So there's certainly space under the act for the government's Women, Peace, and Security strategy to address ways in which the government can better address the myriad roles that women have, both as foreign fighters and as having a role in
conflict prevention.
It is, but there's language there about violent extremism, so there is space for the executive branch to certainly, as part of their strategy, to address that. And so there, I'd hope that the government looks at all the issues that we've talked about and include attention in the intelligence indicator side to how U.S. government's trained, to hopefully having some more investment from security sector pop. So addressing this as a security sector issue, as a governance issue. So I think there's a full agenda that we've laid out. And in fact, separately, Congress mandated a women in CDE strategy that's been stuck in the clearance process in government and hasn't been delivered yet. But there's that separate policy. And as I noted earlier, the government actually is right now working on a national strategy on countering violent extremist groups. And so I'd also very much hope that that attention to women and terrorism, women and violent extremism, doesn't stay only in the Women, Peace, and Security strategy or the Women and CDE strategy, but that the broader U.S. government strategy around violent extremism gives due and gives attention to the roles of women that we've talked about today, because if it doesn't, then that overall U.S. government strategy of addressing violent extremism will be weaker, will be missing key actors that are influencing extremism and countering extremism efforts.
There's also the Democracy and Human Rights coming through the pipeline, too.
Right, so there's...
And could I just follow up and ask how you are defining extremism in this context?
So I mean, here thinking about... where groups are using violence and terror to advance their ideology, to advance their political and social goals, but welcome if others, their political goals.
And be quick. With regards to the Women, Peace, and Security Act, I think it was a real relief when that finally came through. What to do next is a bit of a puzzle. I think that there's a strong mandate for sort of mainstreaming the Women, Peace, and Security Act. And as dismissive as my tone just was, I do think that that's really critical, that gender can't be a side component for all of these various agencies. And that's going to require a really significant effort to integrate gender analysis into a variety of different bureaucracies, into a variety of different bureaucratic tasks. So that's going to take a lot of consulting with gender experts to tailor gender analysis to a variety of different research agendas within the government. Selfishly, I'll say that we should really be focusing on getting more funding for research into women in violent groups, specifically for early career female researchers. That should be an administrative priority. I've said it. But more substantively, we need to really start looking at better serving women in DDR programs, and I think that Nini raised a really important issue. It can't just be soap making and sewing. That's not really engaging with the experiences that women have had in wartime, either as perpetrators or victims. It's not addressing the diversity of experiences. And even though that we knew this back in the 90s, there's been a number of really great studies as to the failings or successes of the Sierra Leone and Liberian DDR processes where there was significant female participation in armed groups. We haven't really integrated those lessons learned into designing better DDR processes for the types of groups that we're dealing with today. And so engaging with what is the protocol if a woman wants to demobilize with the man that she married in the course of the conflict? What is the process if she married in the course of the conflict and doesn't want to demobilize with her husband? There's a variety of really nuanced, thorny issues about women's experiences in wartime and how we can best serve them as the conflict draws to a close that I haven't necessarily seen the policy community engaging with. And so I would really like to see the WPS mandate be used to strengthen those programs, and that sort of design needs to be going on now while the conflict is still going on, because if you start to plan once the guns have been silenced, I think if I were a betting woman, I would bet that the guns would start to attack again soon. But that's all I'll say for now.
First, maybe separately, I'd like to know a little bit more about the indicators about women and the position of women in society, because it seems first directly related to Islam and not to extremism, more broadly, not to Marxist groups, not to nationalist groups, not to the FARC for sure. And it also, you know, I've always had a problem with the indicators themselves, but it seems a bit inaccurate in that, you know, I was recently in Tunisia doing work with women who were joining the Islamic State and meeting with them, and here you have a highly secular state and the highest number of female recruits joining the Islamic State. And so again, some of the indicators themselves, I think, come out of frameworks of gender that are largely outdated. In terms of the research question, I wasn't as much suggesting the scale of the study as I was the type of study. I think that actually a lot of the work, if you're able to break down these barriers of othering and other types of things that exist within the research space, they are actually macro issues, right? It's a type of research, it's qualitative research that's being done. If you're able to do qualitative research on militarization, right, and the impact that has on women's everyday lives, and the types of vulnerability that creates, and the desire for power connected to a gun, then you can map it on to a high school in Atlanta where women have to go through 5 checkpoints, or the Bronx where they're being traced for patterns of life because their husbands are Muslim. And you can understand the political impact of militarization, how it changes women's politics. Now, I think that, again, we're able to see that in women in this country. If you had a single woman on welfare in a relatively impoverished community, one would expect she'd be a Democrat, right? But if you've been living under occupation, you've been living in militarization, you've been raped by a soldier, you've experienced shelling nonstop for 90 days, we expect that our politics doesn't change. Once you're able to draw these together with a different kind of research, what I would, you know, argue are missing indicators, right, where the state is heavily involved, questions of rape, how they shape women's politics, right? Once you understand that all of these things have a political impact, then it's very easy. What is the political outlet for them? If it shapes their politics in ways that make them ally with hardline extremists, fundamentalists, whatever you want to call them, what political outlets are available? It cannot just be 6 seats given to you by UN women. That's not going to work. It can't be a sewing machine. It can't be a cake. It can't be, you know, right? These are highly politicized. I'm right now creating archives of the resistance in Sri Lanka and Kashmir and other places for Stanford. I mean, I'm looking over 50 years of women's intense politics, of poetry, of art, of their own political writings, right? This was the space which they had to express that, right? I can't say that I'm well-versed in, you know, the laws, and I certainly don't advise the administration, but I can say that this is the aspect that is missing. I've spoken in Congress several times about material support for terrorism laws, you know, which haven't changed at all. Most of the areas we were working in with non-state actors after the tsunami, during the war, in Pakistan after the earthquake, the idea that NGOs would be shut down for material support when most of these young people you're working with want to be a social worker or a teacher, because you're going to cut off any aid that goes into these areas. These policies are fundamentally counterintuitive. In terms of the research also, it's a question of who does the research. Right? At City College now, the program that I started, the initiative, is to say, look, at City College, we have 80% immigrant, 70% women of color. Every time there's a conflict, we see a spike, Somalia, Afghanistan, from the students who are in our classrooms. Why are they not the ones who are researching Aleppo? Why are they not the ones researching Pakistan? Right? So the program I started is to train these young women to be the ones who do the research. You don't need to put a lot of money into that, but you're going to get better research out of these young women than you will from outsiders who go in. And in terms of the policy, the one thing I would say is that I know that in the US government it is siloed in development and defense and all of this. What's fascinating is one of the lines that runs through them is gender. You know, it's approached almost exactly the same across all of them. And the programming consistently falls back into this idea of taking a damaged woman to normal. This idea of a woman being a peace builder, that again is something that's normal. Right, this idea of a clean intervention, right, to do with gender. This is all language that I've heard from State Department people. And you know, this approach in the report that we wrote can actually be traced back to the colonial lives. There's an English woman's journal that talks about how one should intervene in the developing world for women. And you can almost map the language exactly onto USAID documents today. So that has to change across all of the agencies.
I know we run over, so I'm going to be very, very brief. When you're talking about indicators, particularly we get asked for indicators of radicalization, sort of how we define the term is the belief that non-state violence to achieve political or social means is necessary and justified. That does not necessarily constitute or cross the line into criminality. Much of that type of activity is First Amendment protected speech. So I think when people talk about indicators, particularly on the individual level, they're looking for when someone has already mobilized to conduct violence, to support violence, or somehow otherwise facilitate violence. And so where this has become difficult in the ISIS space is, again, this lower barriers to entry. No longer do you need to assemble the components of an IED. You can get in your car. You can pick up a knife. You can pick up a gun that may be already available in your home. You can take a book of matches and go to your school, as the woman in Minnesota did recently. So I think indicators for us are particularly problematic as the terrorism landscape changes. And so one of the things that NCTC's done is done some community awareness briefings in conjunction with the Department of Homeland Security and others, where we're invited to go in and meet with law enforcement and community leaders and walk them through some of our research and our understanding, and also walk them to sort of composite case studies and start some of those dialogues. If someone like this presents themselves in your community, what are you going to do and what resources are you going to bear? And again, sort of some of that good community policing and building those relationships in places where maybe they're not that strong. And then I think on the research side, particularly looking at low end incidents, looking at high profile incidents, looking at incidents that have manifested in violence, I think where this is very difficult is to determine why some people chose not to, women in particular. So what walked someone right up the line in some of these cases, and then a different outcome, they made a different decision, they had different influences. So I think that we spend a lot of time kind of dissecting things that have already happened and maybe don't talk enough about why sometimes the outcome was different and nonviolent and pro-social.
Well, guys, big day. I just want to say thank you all for coming, and a very, very special thanks to our panelists here today, and on behalf of the George Washington University Program on Extremism and our partners at the Georgetown Institute for Women, Peace, and Security, thanks so much.